everyone, this is Abdul from Pythonist. Dictionaries are playing a crucial role in the entire Python's implementation. So it is very important to understand this data structure very well in order to write the performant programs in Python. So let's try to deeply understand this data structure. Dictionaries are very good at element insertion, deletion, and retrieving, and provide big O of one-time complexity for all of these operations. Hash tables are the engines behind Python's high-performance dictionaries. Let's take a look at an example to understand how the implementation of dictionaries works behind the scene. So we have a dictionary of root names. So behind the scene, a hash function will be applied to this data structure and creates a hash table where keys has been assigned an integer index by applying a hash function. So the hash function is the most important part of this entire workflow. A hash function maps a larger space of inputs to a smaller space of outputs. So it means that the hash function can be used to convert a large space of keys to a smaller space of integer indices of indexes. The built-in hash function works directly with built-in types and falls back to calling dender hash for user-defined types. If two objects compare is equal, their hash values must also be equal. Otherwise, the hash table algorithm doesn't work. For example, because 1 equal to 1.0 is true in Python, so the hash of 1 equal to hash of 1.0 must also be true, even though the internal representation of an integer and a float are very different. So let's dive a little bit deeper into hash table in the context of inserting and retrieving for dictionaries. In order to create a hash table from scratch, we start with some allocated memory blocks similar to what we started for arrays. The placement of the new data is dependent on two properties of the data we are inserting: the hash value of the key and how the value compares to other objects. This is because when we insert data, the key is first hashed and masked so that it turns into an effective index in an array. The mask makes sure that the hash value, which can take the values of any integer, fits with the allocated number of buckets. So in short, the mask is the reserved number of buckets minus 1. So for example, if we have allocated 8 blocks of memory and our hash value is, for example, 28,975, we will consider the bucket at index 28,975 module 0B111. And 0B111 is the binary representation of number 7, which we can get from the number of allocated memory blocks minus 1. And if our dictionary has grown to require 512 blocks of memory, then the mask becomes 0B111111111, which is the binary representation of number 511. So actually, we have done with the first step of the insertion operation. Now, we must check if this bucket is already in use. If it is empty, we can insert the key and value into this block of memory. If it is used and the value of that bucket is equal to the value we wish to insert, then the key value pair is already in the hash table and we can simply return that. But one another scenario is also existed here. So think about if both of these values are not equal or not similar. Then we must find a new place to put the data. To find the new index, we compute a new index using a simple linear function, a method called probing. Python's probing mechanism adds a contribution for the higher bits of the original hash. Using these higher order bits gives each hash a different sequence of next possible hashes. which helps to avoid feature collision. There's a lot of freedom when picking the algorithm to generate a new index. However, it's quite important that the scheme visits every possible index in order to evenly distribute the data in the table. How well distributed the data is throughout the hash table is called the load factor. The linear probing only deals with the last several bytes of the hash and disregards the rest. But the perturbed scheme that Python uses will start taking into consideration more bits from the item's hashes in order to resolve this problem. A similar procedure is done when we are performing lookups on a specific key. The given key is transformed into an index and that index is examined. If the key in that matches, then we can return that value. If it doesn't, we keep creating new indices using the same scheme until either find the data or hit an empty bucket. And in the case of an empty bucket, we can conclude that the data doesn't exist in the table. So I think that's enough explanation about the entire process. Let's try to elaborate it with the help of an example. So let's say we have a dictionary with the following items. As Rome for value 4, San Francisco for value 3, New York for value 5, and Barcelona for value 2. Let's perform the process of insertion and lookups step by step. So in the very first step, we will reserve a continuous sequence of buckets in memory. Let's say we reserve 8. Then we have to define the mask. So by taking 8 blocks of memory means we have a mask 8 minus 1 is equal to 7. And its binary representation is 0B111. Then in the third step, to insert the first item, which is room, we will calculate the hash of the room with the help of hash function and our mask, and it will be 2. And we will perform the same process for San Francisco, New York, and Barcelona. But for the Barcelona, if you calculate its index, once again using the hash function and mask, it will also be 2, which is similar to the index of room. So at this stage, we have a collision problem here. So to solve this issue, we will use the perturb scheme, which will calculate the new index using the previous hashes. So I will place it before the New York. Don't worry about it right now. You will see the reason shortly. So that's the complete process of insertion and lookups. Let's talk about the deletion process. When a value is deleted from a hash table, we cannot simply write null to that bucket of memory. This is because we have used nulls as a sentinel value while probing for hash collision. As a result, we must write a special value that signifies that the bucket is empty, but there still may be a value after it to consider when resolving a hash collision. These empty slots can be written to it in the future and are removed when the hash table is resized. So that was the reason for placing Barcelona just before the New York instead of just after San Francisco. Okay, let's talk about the resizing. As more items are inserted into the hash table, the table itself must be resized to accommodate it. It can be shown that a table that is no more than 2/3 full will have optimal space savings while still having a good bound on the number of collisions to expect. Thus, when a table reaches this critical point, it is grown. In order to do this, a larger table is allocated. The mask is adjusted to fit the new table and all elements of the old table are reinserted into the new one. This requires recomputing indices since the changed mask will change the resulting index. As a result, resizing large hash tables can be quite expensive. However, since we only do this resizing operation when the table is too small, as opposed to on every insert, the amortized cost of an insert is still big of 1. By default, the smallest size of a dictionary or set is 8. On resize, the number of buckets increases by 4 times until we reach 50,000 elements, after which the size is increased by 2 times This gives the following possible sizes: 8, then it goes to the 32, then it goes to 128, then 512, then 2048, and goes on. It is important to note that resizing can happen to make a hash table larger or smaller. That is, if sufficiently many elements of a hash table are deleted, the table can be scaled down in size. However, resizing only happens during an insert operation. That's great. We have learned a lot, so let's try to write some code and implement our own custom dictionary in Python, so you will be able to understand all the concepts practically. So I will define a class named as MyDict. I'm not using any base class. Then let's initialize some values like size and hash map inside the dir init magic function, which will take the context. And inside that function, I will define the size of the dictionary. If we remember that the default size at the beginning is 8, and I will use the same size. So I will say self.size equal to 8. Then we will reserve the memory buckets of that size as hash map. Okay, let's define a hashing function named as custom underscore hash, which will take the context and the key. And we will produce the index by calculating the hash of the key divided by the size of the reserved buckets minus 1 and return that key. After that, I will define the insert function named as insert underscore item, which will take the context, key, and value. Now inside this function, we will get the index from our custom underscore hash function and set the key underscore exist to false because we are assuming that the memory bucket is empty. Then get that bucket of memory from hash map as bucket equal to self.hashMap into the hash key. And then iterate the key value in the case of existence using a for loop and set the key underscore exist to true and break the loop or save the item. In the either case, we will append the new key value into the bucket. That's for the insertion. Now I will define a function to get an item named as get underscore item, which will take the context and the key for lookups. And inside that function, once again, we will get the index and memory buckets and return the value in case of existence or the key error in case of not exist by using a for loop. That's great. We almost done with our own implementation of a dictionary. Let's create an instance of our custom dictionary class as d equal to myDict and insert an item by calling its insert underscore item method and print out the result. You can see the result here. If you remember that in Python's implementation of dictionary, we use list-like syntax to insert or get our items. But here, in the case of our own custom implementation, we are calling corresponding functions directly. To achieve this functionality, we have to utilize some magic functions from Python like setItem and getItem and point the relative functions to them. That's great. We have learned a lot. I'm stopping it here just to avoid more complexity, but we'll implement the delete function also in the text version of this tutorial. I'll post the link in the description below, so check it out if you want more explanation and the delete function. So that's enough for this video. If you like this video, be sure to subscribe to my channel and hit the bell icon so you will never miss any fantastic video in the future. Thanks for watching.